Okay, I want to move on to urine albumin. Urine albumin is a marker for kidney damage, and particularly for glomerular damage. In addition to being a marker for kidney disease, increased urine albumin is a marker for cardiovascular disease and thought to be a reflection of generalized endothelial damage. Urine albumin results can be used in many ways. It's obviously a way to identify diabetic kidney disease, and you all do that. And in the general public, about 40% of the people identified with chronic kidney disease is on the basis not of decreased GFR, but on the presence of elevated urine albumin. It's very important to understand that increased urine albumin is a marker for progression, especially in diabetic nephropathy. So if you see someone who has 1,500 milligrams of albumin per day, even if their GFR appears to be normal or close to normal, they are probably in big trouble and likely to progress fairly rapidly. The final use for urine albumin, which you may not be taking advantage of, is that it's an excellent tool for educating patients. Because as I can show you later, everything that we do to lower urine albumin slows progression of kidney disease. And if you can report to patients that the amount of albumin in their urine is less and that everything we know suggests that their kidneys are likely to function better for a longer period of time, they will find that helpful. It's no harder to explain than hemoglobin A1C or estimated average glucose or estimated GFR. So it's important. Albuminuria is associated with increased mortality in all people, male, female, black, and white. There's not data from this report on American Indians, but it's true. Now, how do we assess urine albumin? Now, first of all, you notice I'm saying urine albumin because, and I may use it indistinguishably with proteinuria. I'm not going to talk about proteinuria because protein creatinine ratio and proteinuria is kind of going to go away. And the reason is it's because it's such a heterogeneous collection of materials, it's not a test that can be standardized. And we're moving more and more towards laboratory tests that we can standardize, which means you get the same result at every lab across the country. That will never be true for total protein or urine protein creatinine ratios. So what we're all moving towards is measurement of urine albumin, and it's the urine albumin to creatinine ratio that we use for assessing kidney disease. And this is a collection that's based on a spot urine specimen. And what we look at is the ratio of urine albumin to urine creatinine in that spot specimen. So why is that useful? Well, we know that the ratio on a spot specimen is equivalent to the ratio or similar to the ratio in 24 hours. So if you have twice as much albumin as creatinine in a spot specimen, you'll have twice as much in 24 hours. Why does that help you? Well, it helps you because on average, most people put out about 1 gram of creatinine in 24 hours. So as a result, the ratio on that spot specimen is equivalent to the excretion in 24 hours. And the way it's usually reported is milligrams albumin per gram creatinine, which is the same as milligrams of albumin per day. Now, historically, the upper limit of normal is 30 milligrams per gram, or 30 milligrams per day. And that will probably change, but I'm not going to go into that right now. So the thing is that this is a continuous variable. So 30 is worse than 20, 200 is worse than 100, 350 is worse than 250 milligrams per day. There is nothing magic about going to 300 or over 300. Traditionally, what we've done is described 30 milligrams to 300 milligrams as microalbuminuria. And so 30 to 300 is the range between what's the upper limit of normal and what is picked up at with 1+ on the dipstick, which is approximately equivalent to 300 milligrams per gram. Now, and that's where the term microalbuminuria came, and above that was macroalbuminuria. This is sort of confusing to most people and unnecessary because there's nothing that happens at 300 that's physiologic. So what we're moving towards is the test will be urine albumin, it will be based on an albumin-creatinine ratio, and it will be reported as a continuous variable. And I think IHS is moving in that direction, which is a good thing. Now, the way to explain urine albumin, this is a form that we developed that I will discuss briefly at the end of the talk, but you know, it's basically meant to explain the urine albumin at a level that's between the fourth and sixth grade, and it uses these diagrams here, which were developed at tremendous taxpayer expense. But the ability to explain this to patients is quite important, and most patients find it very helpful. You know, you say, look, we put you on the lisinopril, your blood pressure came down, and the amount of albumin in urine went down by half. Now, you can't feel that, but that's a sign that your kidneys are much happier. Okay, so what happens to people with diabetes, and why did they get kidney damage? Well, people with elevated blood sugars filter more sugar in their urine, and through their and there's an, the kidney attempts to reabsorb sugar, and when that happens, it reabsorbs water and salt as well. That leads to some volume expansion. There's a hormonal response, which results where the kidney tries to respond to that volume by increased blood pressure. Pressure and flows in the kidney, and that is called hyperfiltration, and that's one of the ways in which the kidney gets injured. And so what happens in the natural history of diabetic kidney disease is that this red line here is GFR. So initially, when someone develops hyperglycemia, their GFR goes up. And then over time, as kidney damage begins to occur, it starts to decline on a steady path. Around the time that it passes back down through the normal level, right around here, urine albumin starts to go up. And so at this point, when kidney disease is really being manifest, GFR appears normal, but urine albumin is elevated. That's why urine albumin excretion, what we used to call microalbuminuria, some people still do, is the first sign of diabetic kidney disease. So over time, the albuminuria goes up, sometimes to extremely high levels, and here, this is this gray line, and here's the scale, while GFR declines. And then GFR, albumin doesn't really begin declining until GFR gets so low that there's just very little albumin being filtered. So on average, it takes about 10 years to develop clinical signs of kidney disease in diabetes, and another 10 to 15 years to lose kidney function in those people who develop progressive kidney disease.